Just to welcome you to Basel this morning. Over the course of the next hour, my intention is to outline for you some of the changes in the employment and higher education landscape, what that means for your son and daughter, and the students themselves, and what the variety of options are that are open to them for their futures. It's quite an interesting headline last week, which tickled me a little bit, but we are living in a generation where more people have applied to Love Island than applied to Oxford and Cambridge last year. And as one of the governors pointed out to me last night, also will have higher earnings because of it than Oxbridge graduates. I think that's rather sad. I'm sure there's many students that enjoy watching it at the moment. I think it's really important that we equip our young people with the right information and skills so that they are able to make the best decisions for them personally. There will hopefully be time for some questions at the end, so please, if there's anything you want to ask, if there are some blank pages at the back of the booklet that you've got, do make a note and we'll try and deal with all the questions. We're also recording this morning's talk as an experiment, if it goes well, for those parents that can't be with us today, particularly for our international students whose parents are away from labour, so just so you're aware of that. Okay. You have the class of 2019 sitting on here with us. It's quite a sad statistic, but they need to remain income generating until the mid-2060s. Up to 65% of the students sitting in this room will work in jobs and careers that don't exist yet. To stay ahead, they're going to need skill, they're going to need agility, know-how and sheer resilience. This graph was given to me at a graduate careers conference. I found it fascinating. Quite interesting, I'm sure there's quite a few parents in the room who do work in finance. Finance and accounting, around 50% of jobs in those industries which could be replaced by AI, by automation, in the not too distant future. I think politics isn't far behind, actually, it's the third bar on the graph. The challenge for us is to make sure that we're not accidentally preparing students for the jobs for now, but we're actually preparing them for the jobs of the future. And we want them to leave Felsted with the skills that they need, not just to be employed, but also to be employable. And it's a small difference, but knowing that difference could make the difference between career life and death for them. Dr. Paul Redmond of the University of Liverpool has done a lot of research into this, into what he calls the so-called zombie jobs. They're the jobs which are basically on their way out. From that, he's established the types of jobs that we'll be training our students for are going to be very, very different. And indeed, statistics from the various university conferences I've been to in the last few weeks indicate a massive, massive rise in applications to computer science degrees. And link to that and need for students to have a good understanding of maths if they're going to work in those areas. Automation is not the only threat to our students. It sounds very doom and gloom, I'm sorry, I'm just trying to explain it all really. The government levy, I'm sure many of you have heard of, which is being placed on medium and large businesses. They're increasingly offering apprenticeships because of that levy. A number of the big graduate recruiters have confirmed that they're going to be offering less, if not no, graduate opportunities from 2020. The experience and skills of an employee that they grow in-house, taking through their own apprenticeship schemes, and we're sort of looking at, you know, they've done a three-year degree apprenticeship and they're applying for a job in-house against someone that's just come out of university. The student who's had the apprenticeship and the work experience is going to be much better equipped to carry on the vision of that company. The next slide shows a little bit about graduate vacancies as they stand at the moment. And there are some big changes. You can see the bottom one particularly, the number of vacancies that you expect to be filled from work experience programmes offered by those companies to undergraduates. Investment banking, 78% of vacancies are filled from their work experience schemes. This is, you know, very high in law as well. So that also highlights how important it is for all of the students here to have meaningful and real-life work experience during their sixth form career and then at university. We've spoken to them all last week about getting work experience this summer. Obviously, use connections where you can, but if you're struggling to get work experience, we're building a database of opportunities using the First Step Network, using the OF body, and also parental connections to try and find some more opportunities for you. About 33% of graduates that recruited to the big firms last year came from those who completed work experience or internships with those companies. And just to note for the year ahead, sort of beyond, it's really vital for those of you that go to university to start looking for those opportunities in your first term. A lot of people get them, like, yeah, first year, don't have to worry much, I'm here for 3 years. But actually, the students that really get on can come out with the best vacancy and best jobs at the end of it are the ones that look for the internships and the work experience opportunities early on and start applying for those from that very first term. So as I said, everybody's expected to do some work experience this summer if they can. They do need to fill in the appropriate forms for that, which are in the careers room. They're also on our specialist careers website, which the students access through our MIS intranet. So they have been briefed on what they need to do, and I'm hopeful that we're going to have some fantastic opportunities. So linked to that, the way in which students are recruited into the jobs of the future are changing as well. We are going to through your tutorial programme next year, but also through some standalone workshops, give you the skills to deal with the way the recruitment is changing. It's increasingly digital. The CV is a dying art, you still need to know how to do one, but when we were applying for graduate jobs, which is quite a few years ago now, people might send out speculative CVs and so forth. Nowadays, it's kind of almost flipped on its head, and graduates are speculatively sending out messages through LinkedIn. They're looking at LinkedIn profiles. LinkedIn profiles are also really important for the application process itself. Several of the big graduate recruiters actually just lift the LinkedIn profile straight into their digital application form. There then is a digital test that's completed online and a digital interview, which will be sometimes automated. I know someone was saying to me yesterday that their son was basically interviewed by a robot for a job. It speeds up the application process, but obviously it means that the skills need to be there to be able to keep with the progress that's being made. Okay. What it does mean is there's lots of opportunities open to you. We've got sort of four main pathways that we're looking at. Employment, so those people that will go into the school schemes at 18. The apprenticeship route, the higher and degree apprenticeships, particularly that are aimed at the post-18 market. Applying to a UK university through UCAS, and also looking at international universities, so Europe, America, Canada, and the Far East, and beyond, really. We're actively encouraging every student in sixth form to consider two pathways. So if they're applying for a degree through UCAS, why not consider applying for a degree apprenticeship as well? We're going to talk more about apprenticeships once we've covered universities. If you set in a particular career like medicine, you apply through UCAS to medical schools in the UK, why not consider applying to European medical schools? Some very good medical degrees, often with slightly lower entrance tariffs at some of the bigger European universities. It's really important as well to recognise Russell Group universities are not necessarily the best path for everyone. The higher tariff universities, most of which form the Russell Group, have excellent qualities, and many of them have done very well in the new league tables and so forth. But they don't always offer the right fit for your young person. And we'll talk a bit more about that in a moment as well. Okay, I love this graph from UCAS. It depresses me greatly. You lot are at the bottom, right at the dip. So that is the UK 18-year-old population. So 2020, demographically, is the lowest number of 18-year-olds. As I have a 12 and 14-year-old son, it goes right back up by the time they'll be going through this process, which is why it depresses me. the UK 18-year-old population doesn't stop falling. You are the second lowest cohort to go through in terms of demographics. So those people that were here from Mr. Atkinson's Oxbridge talk know it doesn't also mean that it's not competitive still. There are actually more people applying to the higher tariff universities and actually they're getting better, the quality's getting better. The government cap on university places was removed a few years ago. That's meant that universities, some universities, are engaged in progressive marketing. They're in the mission to get ones in seats. And that marketing includes what you may have heard of in terms of adjusted and unconditional offers. However, tuition fees. We're increasing tuition fees. At the moment, the average is about £9,250 per year if you're applying to, as a UK student or an EU student to a UK university. That's why I think there's a lot of people sitting in this room who are considering, do we want to earn while I learn and go through a degree apprenticeship? Okay, it's not an easy option. So what I'm going to do now is talk you through UCAS first, because historically about 95% of our sixth form apply to go to a UK university through UCAS. And then I'm going to talk you through a little bit about the international application process, and I'm going to finish off with apprenticeships. So, first thing to think about is the research, and the young people have already been doing quite a lot of research and asking me a lot of questions about the university that they wish to go to. There's two things really to help them. First of all, every single member of the Lower Sixth has been signed up to a career software package called QDOS. They've all filled in, or should have done, the questionnaires on that. There's a My Future, which is psychometric testing. There's a My Skills, which looks at their specific skill set. And particularly for those that really don't know what they want to do, that helps to sort of direct you in career paths. And it's got many layers they can research, just finding out about the type of career, what the qualifications are they need to do it, what the earning potential is, where they can study it. And that software package they can log into at home, and at school. It's got real-time links to the UCAS course search tool. It's got real-time links to the government's apprenticeship, finding apprenticeship search tool, and real-time links to Indeed if they're looking for a job at 18 as well. So there's a lot in there for them. Most importantly, it also has a personal statement builder, and every single member of the Lower Sixth is expected to do their personal statement in it, and part of the reason for that is so we can monitor it. It also has a CV builder, so there's lots in there to play around with and to really use as a starting point. Once they've done that, then considering league tables and TEF, as some of you will have heard of TEF, not many of you, I don't expect. It's something the government brought in, I think, 2 years ago, Teaching Excellence Framework. It's a way that they are grading universities in the UK, and I'm going to explain that separately in a moment, because it can be interpreted in a number of ways. It's really important for the students to research the university that they're thinking of going to. Visit the campuses. You can do that on the open days, although, as we've said to them, try not to miss more than 2 days of school, and you do need to fill in forms to go during school time. A lot of the open days fall just after we break up. But you can also visit the universities independently, get in touch with their outreach teams. I'm sure they'll be happy to show you around if you make the open days. Think about how the courses are assessed. If you don't like exams, then you want to be looking for a course which maybe is taught using something called problem-based learning, where you might be given problems and work in seminar scenarios and has a high coursework element. I also just put in here as well, I think it's really worth considering university mental health provision. A quarter of people in the national population on average supposed to be having some kind of mental health issue. If those are things which have affected you in the past, it's worth looking at what the university offers. Universities are getting much better. There used to be a huge mismatch between what young people were offered up to the age of 18, and then they're kind of just left by the wayside after 18. Universities, particularly student minds, are working to improve and develop their provision in that area. A statistic I was given when I was at Bath last week, there were 16,000 students at Bath, and they asked how many students do you think accessed our counselling services at Bath last year, and somebody said, I don't know, about 100? I said, probably 4,000, because that's a quarter, and they said, yes, 4,000 students at Bath last year accessed their counselling services there. So it's really worth knowing what's on offer to support you with your wellbeing at university as well. Some, again, sport's a really big factor. Three top universities for sport: Bath, Loughborough, and Warwick. Okay, not Warwick, sorry, Durham. So they, obviously, for those of you that are really sporty, you can consider where can I play sport? Is it near a really big rugby club or cricket or whatever? So those are considerations to bring in. The league tables, the Complete University Guide has the 2019 league tables, which have been, the links have been sent to you all last year. You can look at the league tables generally, which is what the screenshot is of here, which obviously is placing Cambridge top, Oxford second, and the London School of Economics third. But they may not be the best universities for the course you want to study. And you've got an option on that. Where's the subjects? And you can actually choose your subject. They may not have the specific subjects. If you're looking at international relations, you actually have to put politics. Though a lot of politics courses will have international relations, even if they don't teach international relations per se. And then you can look at the course rankings for those courses. So you're able to understand really how it compares nationally. Another thing which has kind of come up recently, polytechnics don't exist anymore. And we do hear anecdotally that there's that, oh, you can't go there, it used to be a poly. I was in the first cohort that applied to UCAS after polys disappeared. That was 24 years ago. Yeah, so we're a long, long way beyond the polytechnic argument. Anglia Ruskin, just down the road, used to be a poly. It's top in the country for planning and surveying. So again, look at the individual courses and consider some of the former polytechnics are very strong new universities and actually particularly stand out for the quality of teaching and the style of teaching that's delivered. Because the old universities may be very strong in research and they have the prestige. And again, I've heard lecturers at the old university say some of the new universities do this better than we do. So really keep that open mind when you're doing that research. It is proven as well, you're more likely to drop out if you go to a university based on a name or a status. Okay, so you really need to look at what's the best fit for you. Okay. The other thing to consider in your research is clubs and societies. You know, if you love singing but you're not doing a music degree, was there a choir or, if it's not that kind of music, another form of music club that you can join? If you've been involved with something at school, for example, the MUN, that you've really loved, does that university do something similar? So look at the clubs and societies as well, and sort of dig deep and see, will you actually fit in that university? City versus campus is the other thing to consider. A lot of students love the idea of being in London. London's incredibly expensive in terms of living costs, so there are factors you need to consider as well. Okay. I mentioned TEF earlier. Universities are awarded Teaching Excellence Framework, Gold, Silver, Bronze, or Provisional. Now, the actual measures that they're centred around are teaching quality, the learning environment, and outcomes, and they are based to some extent on the student experience and the student feedback as well. And students obviously want their universities to do quite well in many cases. To break it down further, when you're looking at these measures on whether a university is TEF, Gold, or so on, they will look at how the courses are designed and assessed. They will look at the amount of contact time that students typically spend with tutors, how academically stretched the students are, how well students develop their knowledge throughout the course, and then also look at official statistics regarding dropout rates, student satisfaction, and graduate employment. So the link to that is quite interesting because it's about 85% of our graduates come out with a 2-1 or a first. It's much higher than maybe it was 21 years ago. Okay. They are graded by their current student body. They're graded compared to other universities. They're not graded by subject. So a university may have to have gold, but for your particular subject, not be at that level. Equally, they may be sort of provisional, but actually be gold quality in your particular subject. So don't just sort of be blinded almost by the marketing that will be used around these statuses. A lot of universities, particularly older universities, are in light of this and in light of the rise of the new universities reviewing how they teach and deliver their courses. That's something that places like Durham and Bath are doing quite urgently to remain competitive on more prestige. Also linked to this, when you're doing your research, I found this fascinating. This is the ranked list, so the red, which you may not be able to see as clearly, is where they sit in this sort of overall university rankings. But this is ranked by the universities which were most targeted by the top 100 graduate employers as listed by the Times. It's slightly different to the lead tables. So if you are looking at your degree in terms of how employable you're going to be at the end of it, this is also worth thinking about. And the other place to use for research is, of course, the UCAS website. There's a UCAS course finder. You type in what you want to study, and it will come with all the courses in the country, and then you can link to the individual university websites. They've just launched two new tools. One is the entry tariff filter. This allows you to filter out overambitious courses to look for ones which meet your predictions, so it really filters that down. The other, which I really like, is the offer rate calculator. And at the moment, there is some data available on websites like Which University, where you can look at the percentage of offer rate, applicant offer rate. So for some courses, I've looked at students, there's an applicant offer rate of 100%. For others, it may be midwifery is really low. Midwifery is something like between 3 and 10% applicant offer rate, which I find quite difficult considering we have a shortage in that area. There's just not the places to meet the shortage. I played around with this and put in what I think my predictions should have been. Maybe they were quite as high as I don't know. I put my predictions in and did the offer rate calculator for two courses. So I looked at international and relations and diplomatic politics at University of East Anglia, where it's a really good politics department. I've got a few links with them. And I put it in to study history or archaeology at the University College London, UCL, which is one of the most competitive universities. For UEA, I had a 90% chance of being accepted on the course to study politics. Greater than 90% chance, but for UCL, I've got a 25% chance of being accepted based on my predictions. Okay, so it gives you an idea. It's really good if you're one of those students that maybe your predictions are in a middle range, you're not sure whether or not to apply for a course with quite a high tariff, and plug in the detail, because it again will depend on the course. I was with Durham on Thursday, and they had about 10.1 applicants per place for their politics course. It's their most competitive course. Last year, for geography, they actually accepted nearly everybody that applied to a geography at Durham. But then the caveat there is that because Durham is one of the top universities for geography, they have had a lot less applicants this year, but they've been very high quality applicants. So, again, data is great, but use it carefully. It kind of brings me to the subject of predictions, and this is quite an important one. I know that there are some young people in the room who are nervous about predictions, particularly in light of lower sixth exams. So, what we do, we make optimistic but realistic predictions within school. There's no point us predicting something which is completely unachievable by a student just to access a particular course. But we will apply a prediction that is really at the top end of aspirational that we think they could get. Okay. So I say to students, really, if you're looking at your lower sixth exams and you've got, I don't know, BBC, it's realistic to expect you might get a prediction AAB, which is one grade higher than you performed at this stage. It's really important that we do keep those predictions realistic but aspirational, because we don't want them applying for courses that might not be the right pathway for them, and they struggle to do well on that course because they've had their predictions overinflated. The current market, and particularly because you're at the bottom of that graph of demographically number of 18-year-olds, students who miss their offers, in a lot of cases will still be accepted into the university if it's a near miss. And that's why I'm saying, we don't want students just to be, we will put aspirational but realistic predictions, but we're not going to predict absolutely inflated aspirational predictions just to open the doors, because it's not necessarily the right course for that student. We do, however, encourage every student to make one aspirational prediction because of the current market. Again, anecdotal evidence is saying, if there is a university course you wish to apply for, which has maybe got a higher published tariff than your predictions, give it a shot, because the current market is such that they might, if you've got a really strong personal statement and a strong supporting reference and contextualised information in there, then they might say, this student actually has got real potential for our course, so we will make them an offer, and that offer may be slightly lower than the advertised tariff. They advise doing that for one course. We then advise them to do three, which we call realistic choices, and then have one choice, which is lower tariff, as your insurance there. That brings me further onto predictions, personal statements, and references. This is the bit that happens with the nuts and bolts of the application. Next week, every single member of the Lower Sixth is going to take part in a personal statement workshop with the Universities of Leicester and Bath. They've also had guidelines from us. They have got the QDOS software, which has got lots of hints and tips, and it actually breaks that personal statement down into sections. And that's where they must complete their draft. That enables us to monitor them, to actually give them a little nudge if they're not doing any work on the personal statement. There's also some really good advice if you have to get hold of a copy of this Summers and Private Schools magazine. We've actually been featured in some advice. It's called Stand Out from the Crowd, and that has got advice on the whole UCAS application as well. I've already mentioned the predictions. They obviously go into the UCAS application. We're open, we're transparent about those predictions. There will be conversations between subject staff and students about those, and when it gets to the end of the process, I will have conversations with each individual member of the year before we press send and get that to UCAS. The student's tutor is responsible for writing their UCAS reference, and that will be read by admissions tutors, and it adds context to their application. It gives us a chance. It's also, if there are things that you're doing in school which maybe aren't 100% relevant to the course you're applying for, but really make you a really strong candidate, we'll put that in the reference. We don't want you to waste characters in your personal statement on that. All of the tutors in of your sons and daughters have had training from school and also from King's College in how to put together the best reference, so really want those to be written in the best way with the highest quality, because that can help maximise the potential to get the offers. They're particularly important at confirmation results in August. If you have a near miss, but a very strong recommendation from the school, that can make the difference between whether or not you still get into the course or not. So once the application is ready to be sent off, each student then has to make a payment, and each member of the Lower Sixth, who will be upper sixth by then, will have a one-to-one appointment with me where we'll discuss the application. I'll share with them verbally the content of the reference, and then we will get that sent off. On references, they are confidential. You can make a data access request via UCAS to actually have a physical copy of it, but the students won't be given a physical copy or shared doc with that reference on. There'll be verbal discussions and they'll be talking with their tutors, so the tutors know the student really well and make sure that information gets through in the reference. And obviously, as I say, in the one-to-one meeting with me, I will verbally share the content of the reference and check that they are happy with everything that we're putting. One of the things we will put as well, and it's worth parents being aware, if there are any circumstances, mitigating circumstances, that we need to flag up, the references where we can do it, but we will obviously seek the student's permission to share that information before we do that. So as parents, if there's anything that you feel needs to go in, is a mitigating, you might be like health, that we're even in this, you know, very, very close family, anything like that, then we need to obviously let the HMs know, and they will share that information with me so we can make sure it goes into the reference. Okay. I'm going to stop talking for a minute because we'll talk, I've got a different link for this, because it decided that after I edited it, it suddenly decided flash videos are no longer allowed to be played through PowerPoint. There is a dedicated area on the UCAS website specifically aimed at parents and how you can support your young people with their UCAS application. This is just a 90-minute video about the process of applying for parents. I thought you'd like to support.
Something. making an application to university, so I know how you feel. But using Apply, the online application system can be fairly straightforward. Here's a few things I can inform you about. Your son or daughter can make an application for up to 5 university and colleges, and this is at a cost of £23. To make their application, they can go onto ucas.com, click register to set up their account. Once they have set up their account, there are 7 sections that they can complete. Each section has a video at the top giving them support and guidance about how to complete that individual section. This can be a long process, so I would recommend that they start as early as they can to complete their application form in time for the deadline. In the personal details section, there's the option for your son or daughter to nominate you, a parent or guardian, to speak to UCAS or the universities on their behalf. If you call, ensure that you have the personal ID number and the answers to the security questions available. Once the school have attached the reference, they can send into your son or daughter's application form through to UCAS. Once UCAS have processed the application form, they can then log into Track at ucas.com/track, where they can track the progress of their application form and view any decisions that the universities are making. That's it for the application process. I hope you found this information useful. If you require any further information, then please visit the Parents section of the UCAS website.
Citizens, they're EU or they're non-EU citizens. So just a little bit on this. The process of applying is largely the same. You still have to go through UCAS Apply, you still have to progress through UCAS Track. However, there are a few different aspects of the application. One of those is funding, and obviously for non-EU applicants, then there is the issue of visas as well. And again, we've got somebody coming into school for the conference with Lursic on Thursday who will be talking about how to get visas and so forth for international students. The area of funding is still quite a big unknown for this cohort. I was hoping we might actually have some answers by now, we don't. There are English language requirements for non-native speakers, and Mrs. Guerrero can talk to people about that, but that's all underhand and they're all sorting that out for them. They are detailed in the What Next Guide for parents, which you can watch a copy of. Universities can be different in those English language requirements, so again, if in doubt, it's worth just ringing the admissions office to check what the English language requirements are, and obviously Mrs. Guerrero can help with that as well. The area of funding, I'm going to come to, I've got a slide on student finance in a moment, so I'll talk a little bit more about that. But Brexit is just leaving things a little unclear at the moment. After you've submitted your application, someone who submitted their application, it's £24 now, as you said, £23 on the video, but it is now £24. That's will be paid by card. It can be paid, added to the school bill if needed, but we prefer the payment to be made by debit or credit card. Once we've pressed send on the application, and that has to come from me, the students receive an acknowledgement email. Shortly after that acknowledgement email, we hope that the offers start coming in. Now, the offers can be very different, and I'll just put 2 screenshots here in terms of what the student's view is when they log into UCAS Track. So you've got one there with UCL have offered you a place. You need to click to see the conditions of the offer. The majority of offers are conditional offers, which means that you have to meet a certain grade requirement to be able to get into the university for that place. So those may be typically AAB, BBC, or you might have 36 points. Most Russell Brook universities for IB We're looking anywhere between 32 and 38 point offers, but all will specify a high level requirement. It may be for three subjects, it may be for one. And when you're doing your research, IB people and IB parents, you also need to look at that, because for some courses, they may request a specific subject at high level, and for other courses, they may not need that. So looking at those high level requirements for IB is really important. There are other types of offers out there at the moment. We have had this year a lot of adjusted offers. Adjusted offers are the ones which might be, this is a standard conditional offer, which is AAB, but if you achieve an A in your EPQ, we will reduce it to ABB. So they just drop the grade requirement by one if students get an A in the EPQ. There's two universities that are doing those adjusted offers with a B in the EPQ. On those lines, there's a lot of universities that don't make adjusted offers, but they do really value the qualification regardless of the grade you get for it. They actually, because of the style of learning, so IB students have that with the extended essay. Those A-level students which have done the EPQ, the style of learning is, and management is very much aligned to universities. And there are statistics out there from Southampton, they've done loads of work on this Southampton University. It actually correlates that those students which have completed an EPQ regardless of grade, which about 14% of undergraduates last year had, they're actually getting better first year and better final degree outcomes than those which didn't have it. So for those of you that have done the EPQ, who may be sitting there and go, well, I didn't get an A or B, is it that relevant? Yes, it is. And it can make a difference in confirmation of results again if you haven't done this. There are also adjusted offers. Some universities have used this year, which are, the offer is AAB, but if you make us your firm choice, we'll reduce it to ABB. Okay? So there's a few of those about this year. I do say, please try not to just go, oh great, I'll make them my firm then. Because if that's not the right course, once you've been there and visited it, and so forth, then you do need to consider that. We also have unconditional offers, and these are really rising at the moment. The second most popular university for first year students is Oxford Brookes. And Oxford Brookes have given quite a few unconditional offers. We've got, I think, five or six students in the current upper six that are sitting on an unconditional offer at the moment. And it tends to be the newer universities that are using unconditionals. They used to be traditionally for those students that maybe had some kind of issue just to take the pressure off. They are great in taking the pressure off, but you've got to stay motivated because for graduate jobs, you still need the grades to access those graduate schemes. It's not a case that you get your unconditional offer, great, I've got injury, my degree now, I don't need to worry. There's still a need to keep your foot on the gas a little bit. We also now have what I call conditional unconditionals. And these ones are when they are, your offer may be BBB, but if you make us your firm choice, we'll make your offer unconditional. Oxford Brookes and Nottingham Trent have done a few of those this year. So there's really quite a different spectrum of offers out there. Generally, if you've got a strong GCSE profile, you stand a better chance of getting an unconditional offer than if your GCSE profile is more mixed. But students this year that have got unconditional offers do have quite mixed GCSE profiles as well. So once all the offers are in, the young person then chooses which two of the five courses they've applied for, they wish to continue with the application. And they'll choose one, which is their firm, and one, which is their insurance. The insurance offer should be a lower grade tariff than the firm, for obvious reasons. It's your insurance if you don't meet the tariff for the firm. There are some anomalies to that. I had a student this year who's got two courses which were exactly the same UCAS tariff point offer, but if you made one of them firm, it made it a lower offer, so it's actually ended up being slightly different. But again, when it comes to making those choices about firm or insurance, then the tutors, the house, masters and mistresses, and my careers team are all there to support that decision making. So it's not there to going out into the unknown with it. Student finance is quite an important issue for everybody. The average fees, as I said earlier, about £9,250 a year at the moment. They could go up. What I've seen is just some parents are actually choosing to fund that up front rather than go down the student loan route. What I would say is if you are a parent that is considering funding it up front rather than going down the student loan route, it's worth also considering some of the universities in Europe, because even if there isn't reciprocal funding because of coming out of the EU, some of the European universities still have lower fees than the UK universities. So, just a note about Brexit, this is, I know that there'll be some UK students looking to apply to Europe, there will be some European students obviously looking to apply through UCAS. At the moment, reciprocal funding, which is where if you go, for example, to study in Holland in an English-speaking course, you would only have to pay, them, I think it's about £1,000 tuition fees per year that they charge in Holland, because we are all members of the EU. That is not guaranteed for this year group, okay, because we don't know what's happening with Brexit. The only exception to this is the Scottish universities. The Scottish universities have confirmed that for 2019 entry, they will continue with reciprocal funding. So those students that are EU students that wish to apply to Scotland will still be eligible for not paying any tuition fees, because that's what Scottish students have. A little caveat to that is that therefore means for the European places, it's very competitive. So they will look at taking their free Scottish students first, because they get paid loads of money by the Scottish government for taking them. They'll then look at the food paying students before, and then they'll have a small quota for the EU students for those universities. So as soon as I get an update, I'll obviously share that with students. But we are waiting really, I guess, on the back of the delightful debates that are happening at the moment in the House of Commons to find out where it's going. The rumblings are that schemes like Erasmus, where you can spend a year abroad, will still be running for the foreseeable future, because it's slightly separate from the EU. But we'll see what happens on that front. This segues quite nicely into studying abroad. It's a really viable option for a lot of people. Particularly for those of you that have already been away from home, lived away from home, so it perhaps won't be quite so daunting studying abroad as it might be for somebody that's just sort of been going to a day school for their entire school career. You can access English taught courses in a variety of countries. Bocconi University is one of the top Italian universities, offers English taught courses. It also offers a fantastic World Business degree, which is taught across three different countries, America, Italy, Hong Kong, I believe. It's really important to have a global outlook for the graduate market. We're living in an independent world. Opportunities to study abroad, even on a placement year, part of an Erasmus scheme, or for the whole degree, are really great. Again, different countries have different requirements for entering, so it's really important if you are looking to apply abroad that you speak to me about it. Okay. So, for example, to study in Spain, what they do is they have a special formula where they work out a score, and because the Spanish government like their students to have a broad curriculum, if you're studying the IB, your score will be comparable with Spanish students, but if you're doing A-levels, it will not score as highly. So it's little things like that that will help guide those decisions if you're going to apply abroad as to where you apply. If your sons or daughters are considering applying abroad, most of those that are considering the US have already flagged themselves up to myself and Mrs. Atkinson Wood, who's responsible for supporting them through US applications. If you apply to Europe or further afield and you want some advice and guidance on that, then obviously you need to flag yourself up very quickly. There's a very different process applying abroad, but the great thing about it is once you've gone through the application process, all of the offers are unconditional. So you kind of guarantee once the deposit is paid, then you're guaranteed that place. With America, each year we do have a reasonable amount of interest in Ivy League universities. There are a lot more options out there. There's about 4,500 colleges and universities in the United States to choose from. They have a much broader curriculum than UK degrees. You specialise later on. If you're an IB student, because of the nature of the American system, you actually get credits, which may mean that your course is shortened slightly, and that applies in Canada as well. There's also a number of sports scholarships available to US universities. They're growing into new areas. There's increasing interest in rugby, which we're really pleased about, in the United States. And again, next Thursday, we've got a guy coming in who recruits rugby scholars for US universities who will be leading sessions on applying to America for our students. Again, fees do need paying up front for the other universities, the international universities. As I said, they're incomparable or cheaper in most cases. America, everybody thinks, is really expensive. When you break it down and in the university fees in America quite often include the full package, whereas here we're just looking at tuition. So it's worth going sort of digging into it if you're interested in that route. We are planning two trips in the autumn term for students that are interested in international applications. One for the US applicants to the US Colleges Fair, which is in London on Friday the 28th of September. There's about 150 or more, I think, US colleges coming to that. And there's a World Universities event on the 8th of October, which is a Sunday in London. We're also going to take a minibus and maybe a coach if loads of people want to go. Okay. Back to universities. I'm going to move on to apprenticeships. I've called it the rise of a degree apprenticeship. You've probably heard in the news, there's been a lot of stuff saying, oh, apprenticeship starts to happen over the last quarter. Yes, they have, but not for degree and higher apprenticeships. But the apprenticeship starts that have fallen have been very much for those advanced and intermediate apprenticeships, which are the equivalent of GCSE or A-levels, which you can see here, the different types. So for our students that are leaving school at 18, we would be encouraging you to apply for either a higher apprenticeship, which is the equivalent of a foundation degree, HND, that sort of thing, or for a degree or even a master's apprenticeship. The statistics that have been released show that a degree apprentice is likely to have higher lifetime earnings than a graduate from a cross-group university. The reason for this is partly entering the workforce sooner, of course. It's also to do with best skills and the fast-track progression that they have. Apprenticeships are not for everybody, and there is this sense sometimes to go, oh great, I can go out, hire apprenticeship £17,000 a year, I'll be earning that, and I won't be running up £27,000 worth plus of debt, and I can learn while I earn. But students really have to have a quite frank conversation, I think, with parents, and think, are you ready to join the workplace when some of your peers will be studying at university and having a student life? And you really must have the maturity to be able to do that at that stage. But as I say, on the positive side, you can earn while you learn with a starting salary around 13 to 17,000 or higher, and upwards of 17,000 for most degree apprenticeships with no student debt. So, as I said, there's a widespread report for drop in starts. You can see here where it's gone from 2011 to 2018, what projection for 2017-18 starts on the end there. Degree apprenticeships are growing, and they're growing into an increasing number of areas. I'm not sure if you'll be able to read that slide back fully. Traditional areas that apprenticeships have run have been engineering and related things. We've got nurse degree apprenticeships now, which are going to be running quite locally as well. You've got conveyancer, police constable, insurance professional, teacher apprenticeships are coming. And then at the master's level, you can actually do, I think, 6 years training with one of the big city law firms to train as a solicitor and come out of it pretty much at the same time as somebody that does a law degree and does their LPC and then does their TE traineeship. You'll be at an equitable stage, but having worked in law all the way through, starting with paralegal work. You've also got actuary, accountancy, and so forth in that level 7 apprenticeships as well. So it's moving into increasing areas. The employer chooses which university or college they work with to deliver the learning element of that. I personally think it's important not to worry about which university they link up with because the employer makes that choice. Some examples, Dyson is linked with Warwick. They actually have their own Dyson Institute delivering this. We have an LF there at the moment. And he'll be coming back in the autumn term to run an engineering quiz seminar for students. Goldman Sachs link with Queen Mary's of London, and Accenture link with the University of East London. So there's just a few examples of who they link with. As I said earlier, there is evidence that employers are going to move away from graduate recruitment and more to this, but it's a new and evolving market, so something to consider. So these are the top employers of degree apprenticeships as it stands at the moment. You'll notice Civil Service and BAE Systems are at the top, closely followed by PwC, Deloitte, KPMG. The Times Guide, which is this elite thing at the side here, I've put it on the apprenticeship section of our internal careers website, which again the students can access through the intranet, but the link does work from externally if they copy and paste that for you, and it's going to be embedded within the main school website fairly shortly. There are newer areas that are big employers. Some of the higher apprenticeships, if you're looking at degree apprenticeships, they're really competitive for a lot of these new areas. So it's not like, oh, it's the easy option. They are still very competitive, and you follow the employment processes I talked about earlier on with the digital application. Don't allow, if you're thinking degree apprenticeship, also applying to higher apprenticeships, because, for example, PwC do a two-year higher apprenticeship scheme. That currently leads directly into their graduate scheme, and that's a year before graduates from the same year of school would be eligible for that graduate scheme. So higher apprenticeships are certainly very valuable. The application round for both higher and degree apprenticeships normally open sometime around September, October, and those are open until about February, March time. Those students that are looking at degree apprenticeships and higher apprenticeships, please, please, please follow both the Felsted Careers and Higher Education Twitter and Mrs. McArdle's Felsted Enterprise Twitter, because whenever we get those adverts coming in, a lot of it comes through Twitter, we're retweeting those opportunities for students, and that's the main source of that information for us at the moment. So if you are looking at that route, your sons and daughters are looking at that route, they do need to be following that, so they don't miss any opportunities. And Mrs. McArdle is our apprenticeships advisor, so for, again, those students looking at that, they need to connect Mrs. McArdle and she will put in place the right support for you. Okay, I'm nearly done with you, please. Okay, support here. What are we offering? Well, we've had a rejig of our careers team since Mr. Spring retired. What we're offering is bespoke careers advice and guidance for everybody. Every single member of this year group will have one-to-one appointments with a member of the team to help plan futures. They're obviously working with tutors and HMs as well. We're running a careers drop-in clinic every Friday between 4 and 6pm in the careers library. We're going to be delivering a careers education programme, which will be through mandatory lecture workshops once every half term on Monday, twilight session, plus through the tutorial programme. And we're also having opt-in career seminars in a variety of areas. And those areas, I have listened to what I'm being asked, trying to avoid finance and law at the moment and bringing some different careers that maybe haven't always been there. So in next term, we've got RMSPs currently at the Dyson Institute coming to do one on engineering. We've got one on advertising, careers in advertising. We've got one on careers at sea, looking at the merchant navy, but also broader than that. Got one other, I can't remember what that is at the moment, sorry. And they will be advertised by email, Google form sign-ups. The students will need to sign up for those to come along. And I really would encourage everybody to get along to them, because it's worth finding out about different things. You might suddenly have that light bulb moment. Oh, wow, I never realised it's about that. Would really like to look into that further. And we can help you do that. So we've got a number of staff in the team now, and there are more details on the website about who those staff are. Mrs. McArdle, as I said, supporting apprenticeship and post-school employment opportunities. Ms. Simpson's working with our medics, dentists and vets. Mrs. Atkinson with Oxbridge High School US applicants. Mrs. Sunshine Harris is supporting with UCAS and the Careers Education Programme, and I kind of have an umbrella remit with all of that, supporting the work that they're doing with you, and also the ability of one-to-one interviews as well. So you're aware, there's a couple of events happening in the next week for your sons and daughters to be put in place. We're taking a whole year group to Essex University on Wednesday. It's the UCAS Essex Fair. Lots and lots of universities are represented there. They've got their outreach teams, got loads of prospectuses and freebies for you to pick up, talk to them about the courses that they offer. If you go on the UCAS exhibition for Essex website, which all of the students should have done to sign up for their ticket, and if the link is not working, Google it. And there is a list of exhibitors on that website as well. Thursday, we have a crazily large event happening, which it's the inaugural Futures Conference for all our Essex students. This is hopefully going to become an annual event for all of Lower Sixth as they come through the school. And what we have organised is a professional conference where students come dressed smartly, school uniform. They've each got a bespoke individualised programme. So we start the day at 8:15 and students come and register like you would for a normal conference. We've got two keynote speakers, and I've just realised that unfortunately, our keynote speaker in the morning let me down about 3 days ago, but we've actually secured someone who I think is going to be even better. So in the morning, we have Sally Everest coming, who is the careers lead for the Good Schools Guide. She's doing a lot of work on degree apprenticeships at the moment. She knows pretty much everything there is to know about them, and she's got some amazing contacts. She is going to speak to students about the value of apprenticeships, and then they're going to go out into breakout seminar sessions, of which we've got nearly 60 throughout the day. In the afternoon, we then have Mike Nicholson, who is the Director of Student Recruitment and Admissions at Bath University. He used to work at the University of Oxford and has worked at the University of Essex as well. He's a really inspiring speaker about higher education. And then there's more breakouts in the afternoon. And the breakout sessions, you probably, again, can't read all of that from up there, but to give you an idea of what's on offer, the only one in red, we're still really trying to get a speaker for real estate at the moment. What they've got is a mixture of employability skills and university toaster. So every single student will be timetabled into a personal statement workshop. That is non-negotiable, even if they're not applying for university. They will still have to write a personal statement at some point in their lives on an application form. So it's a really useful process for them to really focus on skills and that ability for that. And hopefully that will get them far enough to go away and actually write it over the summer holidays, which is our expectation. We've got apprenticeships workshops, we've got applying to the USA, applying to Europe. We've got taster sessions. Some of the taster sessions are from academics, so we have the head of the CAS Business School coming in, very popular session, to run some seminars on business. And the taster sessions are meant to give the students an idea of what it's like to study that subject. Well, we haven't got academics, we've got OS who are currently studying the subject at a university coming in to talk about what it's like to do that subject and answer questions. Each member of the Lower Sixth, bar about 10 that didn't do it, have filled in a form where they have ticked which of those sessions in rank order they would like to attend. And we have spent all day yesterday timetabling all into those sessions. So there may be a range of about 5 to 22 students in any one session during the day. And as I say, they all have their individual programmes with the preferences that they have put. If we don't get to real estate one, I will do my best to replace that with something in some linked career for them. So, just to finish off, next steps. In the Futures What Happens Next guide for parents that you've all got, there is at the back a copy of the document which all of your sons and daughters have received. This is past their school deadlines for 2019 entry, 2020 deferred entry. It's very clear on there what the expectations are. The deadlines are all listed on there. By the 27th of June, I'd like them all to have registered on UCAS Supply, and they were doing that for their tutors in the Monday of the last week of term tutorial session. They do need to keep the professional guidance team, our careers team, updated. So if that's just an email to careers admin or to me about choices, particularly those that aren't going through UCAS. Again, it's so we can support you in the best possible way with those choices. The personal statement deadline is on return to school in September. Now, I know you'll be aware that the UCAS deadlines are October 15th and January 15th with UCAS, but we want to make sure that we've produced with your sons and daughters the best possible application for them. And we obviously need time to process that in-house as well. So it's really important that deadlines are stuck to. so that we can do what we need to do in-house to polish that application. On that note, I had just an anecdote, a really good tip from somebody the other day. He said, with personal statements, something that you as parents can do, is when your son or daughter has finished their personal statement, give it to a friend or a colleague that does not know your child, and ask them to read it and describe the person. And if they describe back your son and daughter, then that's a great personal statement, because it's really the idea is that it gets the flavour of who they are across. If the person they're describing to you is a complete stranger, then maybe they need to revisit that personal statement. So, as I said, details of how to register for UCAS will be coming to students shortly, and they need to do that for the summer holidays. And then we are here to support your sons and daughters, but you as well. Any queries, then do get in touch and we can arrange to see you or just deal with the queries by email or telephone. I'm done. Are there any questions?
Hello, yes. How many words, personal statement?
Personal statements are 4,000 characters, 47 lines. It's not a lot, but they will achieve it in the end. We might have to take a bit of a side to cut some of it down. Yes,